Sometimes on this journey, get lost in my mistakes. What looks to me like weakness is a canvas for your strength. My story isn't over, my story's just begun. And failure won't define me, 'cause that's what my father is. Failure won't define me, 'cause that's what my father is. Ooh, lay your burdens down. Ooh, here in the Father's house, shame at the door, 'cause it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house. Find hope. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room. Prison doors fling wide, the dead come to life. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room. Miracles take place, the cynical find faith. Love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. Jericho walls are quaking, strongholds now are shaking. Love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. Love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. Shame at the door, 'cause it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house. Amen.
Amen. Welcome to the Father's house. You may be seated. Well, we're glad to see if a family you've come together here or online to worship So great to, as kids, to come home, isn't it? Just to spend time with our dad. And so welcome, and we want to make sure that we are connected with you if you are newer or you have a chance to share some new information with us. We would love to hear from you. So we have connection cards in the pew, or you can go to Church Center app and you can use the connection card there as well. And give us a chance to connect. And speaking of connecting, that leads into things you need to know, because today we are hosting a potluck after the service called A Taste of Home. So you may get a chance to taste some very different dishes than you would normally have in your home as people share that. So please stay around in the hub and we can enjoy that time together. Also today, a little later, at 4 p.m., we have a baptism happening out at Pipestone Campground. So be sure to come along as well and be able to join with those who are being baptized today. As we begin to plan into the fall, there's a few things that we just want to make you aware of. If you're a ministry leader, you probably have received a number of emails in the last few weeks, so be sure to check your email, especially if you didn't remember or notice. Maybe it went to a junk mail. So we just want to begin planning into the fall. So there's some information that we're looking for as we do that. And starting on September 4th, we have some changes for Kids Connection. So for parents to make you aware of, every year we change grades, of course, and sometimes we've done that in June, but this year we've waited for September. So September 4th will be the first week where your child will be in the new grade as they start the new school year. And as well, we are actually going to go back at that point as well to having the kids join us for the singing portion of the service and then dismiss them into their class rather than check them directly into the class at the beginning. There's just something really special about having them join and see us worship together and being intergenerationally part of that family community together. So we're going to return to that as we've done in the past. And so be aware of that for September 4th. We want to take a few minutes again right now to just have a time of worship through giving. Last week as we were doing baptism prep class, one of the things we talked about was why would we be baptized? And one of the things that as I teach that class often, I emphasize is that there are a lot of different reasons that we could, but the fact that Jesus told us to is enough of a reason to do it. And so learning to take those steps of obedience, actually I see baptism as a really important step to take, because you begin in the small things to take steps of obedience, and then when God asks you to do something that's maybe even harder, you've learned to be obedient in those things. And I was reminded this week of Jesus' parable, Luke 16. Luke 16, Jesus talks about a shrewd manager, and this is what he says. So if you've not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, who will trust you with true treasures or riches? And so in this, we see God telling us, these are little things compared to the real treasures that I could entrust to you. Malachi 3:10, God says, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will not be room enough to store it. And so as we begin a time of giving, I just encourage you to pull out the Church Center app and give that way, or grab an envelope. To me, this is a time as well of obedience, of just saying, God, I hope you can trust me with the little things like worldly wealth and pour into my life the even bigger treasures that you have, the things that you've given me. And we have so much to give. We're going to talk in the fall a lot about how God has given us talents, time, relationships, so many things that are treasures that he's asking us to steward well. So we encourage you to continue in doing that. And so let's pray. So Father, I thank you for all of the blessings that you pour in our lives, all of the treasures you entrust to us. I think as a steward of those things, sometimes we forget that you are giving, sometimes you give us things so we can be giving them away to others, to be a blessing to others. Sometimes we hold them And so, Father, help us to be aware of your economy, the way that you give us things, you give us time, you give us relationships, you give us experiences, so that you can use them to be a blessing to others. Help us to live other-focused. Help us to be obedient. I think today of the baptism candidates and their step of obedience, I pray blessing on them, God. Pray that you would encourage them and help them to continue step by step walking in obedience and pour blessing on that. Father, we pray and remember today as well the Ruxtons as they continue their missionary journey. We thank you for their work, their step of obedience to go, and we pray that you would go ahead of every detail for them, that you would be with them as they travel and all the details around that, but also as they meet with people, as they plan, every step of that, Father, that you would go and be with them in going ahead of what they're doing. Father, I thank you for each person here and all that you've poured into their lives, and I pray that you would this week just encourage them in that next step you're calling them to, that they would in boldness step into in obedience. We thank you, Father, for all our blessings. In Jesus' name, amen.
Darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger.
You're so worthy. You're so worthy. No one else comes close to you. Before I spoke a word, you were singing over me. And you have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. And you have been so, so kind to me. And all the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God, all it chases me down, but still I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't. Coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no wall you won't hide up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't He loves us. Oh, how He loves us. Oh, how He loves us. How He loves us. Yeah, He loves us. Oh, how He loves us. Oh, how He loves us. Oh, how He loves. Yeah, He loves us. Yeah, He loves us. Oh, thank you, Lord. God, You love us so much that we can't even start to comprehend. Saying that we love You too sometimes just feels so inadequate. But we pour our praise back to You, Lord, this morning as an offering of love.
To worship You, oh. Lift our voices one more time.
I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you.
I just want to repent. For much of the morning, the Lord's been speaking to me about giving you a chance to tell him how you love him. I'm going to share a story from Sharon and I, our first year of marriage. I used to be fairly controlling with regard to my finances, and I, you know, made sure that I knew what was going on. And after about a year of being married, I said to Sharon, we'll divide things up. You're going to look after the finances. And she made this statement, which kind of surprised me at the moment. She said, that's one of the most loving things you've ever said to me. And it wasn't loving because I said, I love you. Do you remember that?
Yes and no.
Yes and no. I remember these things. It wasn't loving because she heard the words. It was loving because it was a gesture of trust. And sometimes, and Amanda asked the question and kind of implied, when God says, I love you, to just reply, I love you too, just kind of seems like mechanical. Like, I love you, well, I love you too. And, you know, what else are you supposed to say? Yeah, I like you a lot. You know, what do you do? So, but this morning, we can do more than just say, I love you to Jesus. And what I felt this morning and what I didn't say earlier that I should have said probably from about the second song of worship is that many of you have come into the house of the Lord and we sang, Lay Your Burdens Down, and I just had the sense of how heavy the burdens are that some of you are carrying are. And I actually feel like we're weighted down today. Does anybody else feel that? There's a weight. It's work. You know, we're being faithful and that's good. It's an act of worship to just press through. But sometimes you just, and I want to give you the chance to say, I love you, Lord, in a different way. I want you to tell Jesus you love him by showing him that you're willing to give him whatever these things are that are weighing you down right now. I want you to say, Lord, I love you, and I actually trust you. I'm going to trust you by giving this to you. Do you know what I mean? So that's what we're going to do right now. So in the name of Jesus, we're going to do this. And I'm just going to invite the worship team to play. And I would like you to take the things that are burdening and weighting your soul, the things you are worried about, the things you are stressing about, the burdens that you are carrying. I'm just so good to see Bob in church this morning. I've been praying for him, medical conditions. I'm just thinking about the weight of that. Right? The series of things you've been through, Bob, and many of you are carrying things, so that's how we're going to worship this morning. And it doesn't sound like a very loving thing to do, to throw all your weights onto somebody, except when it's Jesus. And I can think of a situation. I thought of this as well. Have you ever seen somebody get all excited at a sports event and they're looking for somebody to high-five and everybody's turning the other way and nobody high-fives them, and it's just like awkward and sad, right? That nobody, there's nobody to celebrate with. Well, Jesus is going like this. I died for that. I got that. I got that. And he's going, somebody give me some. Somebody give me some. And we're all just sitting here. Oh, you know, life is hard and heavy. And give Jesus a high five. Make the exchange right now. Just give it to him. Kareen and Jen and we're just going to give him, okay? So let's do that. Just begin to speak out loud and say the words out loud, whatever it is you're carrying. Jesus, this morning, I love you, and I know you love me. And so here's what I'm giving you. Here's what I want you to take. Here's what you paid the price for. I'm not going to waste the work of the cross. I'm not going to keep carrying it along in my self-sufficiency, but Lord, I give it to you today because I trust you, because I believe you'll do something about it. I'm going to dare to take a step of faith today. And Lord Jesus, I do love you, and I know you love me. And I'm going to trust that love right now. I'm going to trust it right now. So say the word of the thing. Say the name of the person. You're carrying their burden, or they are a burden. Let's face it, we've got some of those people too. Just name the thing and give it to Jesus right now. Unburden. Give the weight to Jesus. Sometimes you have not because you ask not. Ask Jesus to meet you right there. And now as we do that, it says, don't be anxious about it, but you've made your request known to the Lord. And so now allow the peace of God to come into you, to guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. You see, these are things we actually do. We don't just read them and go, that sounds good. This is a thing you do. You give it to him, and then you allow him to do what he said he'd do. He said, I will guard your heart and your mind. Who needs the guard over their heart and mind this morning? You need the guard of the Holy Spirit. You need angelic security to protect your mind from worry and fear and stress and weight. And so, Lord, we accept today your peace, the peace of God that surpasses our understanding. Without even knowing how you're going to do this, Lord, we are trusting you to do this. And, Lord, we receive from you today ability by the power of the Spirit, through your Spirit, strength and ability to be able to walk out the journey. We're not going to say, I just can't do it anymore. Yes, we can. We can do all things through Jesus. We can do it. Jesus, you can help us do it. You can walk us through. And so, Lord, we lay our burdens down this morning in the Father's house. And we thank you, Jesus, that you've taken them and carried them away. And so, Lord, today, now we choose to walk in light, in optimism, in life, in hope, knowing and trusting a God who cares for us. We do this today, Lord Jesus, because we love you and we know you love us. And it's a great deal for us to be your people. Who feels it? Can you feel it? Can you feel what happens when you give the weight to Jesus? Take a breath. Come up for air. Come up for air. Breathe in. Breathe in. The fullness of God, the presence of the Lord. It's good that you're here this morning. Isn't it? It's good that you're here this morning. Say amen. It's good that I'm here. I need to be here. Turn to somebody and tell them, you need to be here too. Amen. You may be seated. Oh. There you go. Got a little laughter going on. And now we get to do something fun. We get to do a child dedication this morning. We're going to join with Genevieve, and I'm going to, you're going to come on up, okay? I'm going to give you a chance to migrate up here and bring Eliza and whoever else is coming. Bring the whole clan. And I'm going to remind you of an Old Testament story. Her name was Hannah. She was a mom. She didn't have any kids. And so she went to the temple, and she was pouring out her heart to God, not unlike we just did. And Eli, being such a good priest and pastor, thought she was drunk and scolded her. Okay, not the most shining moment of church leadership, but she prayed, and she said, "No, I'm here because I'm barren, and Lord." And so she laid her burden and gave it to God. And by the time she came back the next year, she brought a son with her, and his name was Samuel. And she would keep that child for just a few years. And now, I just want to be clear that a baby dedication is not what Hannah did. Hannah brought her child as about a 6-year-old, 7-year-old, to live in the temple. So I'm not offering to take over Eliza's life and care. However, that idea of bringing our children, bringing these precious ones before the Lord to be used of the Lord, to find their place in the kingdom of God, is a very beautiful biblical practice, and we call it dedication. It's not magic. It doesn't have to do with salvation. It's not a lucky charm. It's nothing like that. It's nothing less than inviting the presence of Jesus and the hand of God to be on our children, and to do it in a public and corporate way, and to ask you to join us in that. And so this morning, it's just a delight to have Genevieve here, and this is Eliza. And who are these other two women here? And why are they important to you?
Yes, they are important. This is a mic. Maybe a mic. Yeah, because now I can hear.
Here, have Mike.
Hi, Mike.
So introduce, tell us why these two ladies are here with you.
Okay, so, I will explain in the dedication why I choose these people with me. But this is Gail, this is a friend, and I have Pastor Kim with me, and you, and all of you, and this is Eliza, and I have one friend as well, Beatrice, who is here.
And how come she doesn't have to come up? She doesn't want to? Okay, that's okay. You don't have to.
But this is like a good friend as well.
Yeah.
Yes, she is important for me and for my family as well. Okay. And I try to speak loud, but I can't anymore. So, and then like that. Okay. Yes. So can I read this part?
No, just before you do that.
Yes. Okay. Bye, Mike.
Take the mic away. French Canadians. Our heart and our passion flow best through our French Canadians. Anyways, as we do a child dedication, we talk with the parents and remind them of the fact that this is a sacred trust. Children are a sacred trust and treasure. The Bible says they are a reward. Children are a reward from the Lord. And so if you have children, remember, they're your reward from God. And maybe depending on the child, you know what kind of a reward you're getting. Having said that, though, a baby dedication is really a dedication of a parent to a plan and a set of values for their children and in their family. And so, Genevieve, you know these things, and you've gone through the course with us, but I'm going to ask you these questions, and I want you, before the body of Christ here today, your church family, to answer to these questions. So first of all, do you commit to living your life in a way that the blessing of the Lord can flow through you into Eliza's life?
Yes.
And do you accept responsibility that God's given you to be the primary spiritual influence in Eliza's life? You are her teacher and her pastor and her mom and all of these things.
Yes.
And are you willing to commit to Jesus' unconditional love for your daughter, no matter what her life brings into your life,
yes,
that you will love her like Jesus loves her?
Yes.
And will you pray for her?
Yes,
and every day, maybe, that the Holy Spirit will lead her into that life-giving relationship with Jesus. That's the number one job of a parent, is to lead their children to Jesus. Okay. Now, to the rest of the church family, we live in community together, don't we? And we don't parent alone, and we have Sunday school teachers and pastors and youth pastors and all the, and so we live together. And the things that we do and say will have an impact on Eliza's life and on Genevieve's. And so I'm going to ask you to stand with us and ask if you are willing to help Genevieve and Eliza see and find the fullness of God's calling in their life as an expression of His love for you. And will you commit to support this family with real relationships, with God's truth, in intentional discipleship, with exceptional stewardship of them, and to share with them a kingdom perspective of living? All right. One of the great joys of child dedications is when parents share the blessing that God's put in their heart. And so, Genevieve, now it's your time to read this.
Okay. Eliza, my mamo. Huh? Are you my mamo? C'est mon amo? Ma mamo? Oui. Hein? Okay. I love you so much, and because I love you, I want you to grow in Jesus' presence. We are so precious for Him, and I want you to know, to walk around people who can teach you His truth. Your journey just began. You have a whole life in front of you. You were so fast to come to meet the world that you were born warm 1 month earlier. Doctors were thinking to lose both of us, but we are here together. In this life, you live such beautiful moments. You will learn to read and to count. Huh? You will have great friends. You will maybe graduate, and you will hopefully get married and have kids and meet Jesus on that path. I won't lie to you. You will also go through hard times or trials, and Jesus will help you in every moment you will face. Can you then? Tiens mon doigt. Que tiens mon doigt. Yeah, tiens mon doigt ici. Tiens mon doigt, mami. Tiens le doigt de mami. Okay. But for now, I want to introduce you to people you can trust and who will give you the instruction you need. Huh? Gail? Who is Gail? Where's Gail? Oh, this is Gail. You know Gail. Gail is one of them. She will guide you. She will teach you the Bible, tell you everything about it. She will tell you how you are precious. She will believe in you like she does already. She will be a good listener, and she will help you to grow your faith in our Lord. She is an amazing, beautiful person, and you can always trust her. Pastor Kim, who is Pastor? Pastor Kim is an amazing guide for you as she is for me. If you have any question, want to know more about Jesus, she is a wonderful resource, and she will pray for you and with you. About my brother and sister in Christ, they will all be there for you. All of them can help you to grow your faith and teach you all to be like Him, to be with Him, Jesus. My precious daughter, Eliza. Hey, Mamo. Mamo. Yeah. I want to let you know that I will do my best to teach you the truth with the scriptures. I will pray to Jesus to help me to teach you everything you should know, you should do or don't. And all of that, I will do it with respect, kindness, and love. Mamo, today, I make you a promise. With Him, you will have a hope and a future. Amen.
Amen.
Mommy. Thank you.
Well done.
Sorry. Thank you.
you want to come up, sweetie?
Yeah,
can we pray for you?
Yeah,
how about, okay, is Mom going to pick you up? Okay. So let's lay hands on her. So Gail, you can come and and let's pray. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for Eliza this morning, and we want to thank you for Genevieve. Today, as Mom dedicates her daughter, we want to thank you for the beautiful bond that exists between mom and daughter, and the fact that, Jesus, you're at the center of it, and that this is their prayer, really, of Genevieve's blessing and of our prayer, is that, Jesus, you would always be at the center of their lives. And so, Lord Jesus, today we thank you for the privilege of dedicating her to you, of asking for your blessing to be on her. We pray protection over Eliza, over her body, over her soul, over her mind, over her spirit. Lord, we pray that she would grow into the fullness of the knowledge of God, and that she would be filled with spiritual power and gifts that are a blessing to the world around her and to her friends. Father, we pray that you would put her in community with close friends who love Jesus as well. Lord, we pray that you would protect her from those who would do her harm. Jesus, you told people to be very careful how they treat children. And Lord Jesus, today we pray that you would protect her. Go before her and behind her, prepare her way, we pray in the name of Jesus. And Lord, as a community of faith, we understand that we live this life together. We need the gifts that each of us have. And so, Lord, we promise today that we will walk with this family, and we will give them the support and the care and the help that we can. We will do our part to love them. And so, Lord Jesus, today we honor you by trusting Eliza into your care and into your plan. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said,
amen,
amen. Amen. Let's congratulate them. God bless you.
Okay.
We have this for you. Well, good morning, everybody. Just before I get started, I just want to shout out to the Grand Prairie Centaurs Rugby Club, because it's their 40th anniversary, because they won their anniversary celebration game yesterday, and because on that team is Russell and Brett Breitkreuz and Michael Penny and Matthias, and Jerome was on that team, and who am I missing? I'm missing somebody. Anyway, so I think I'd be in trouble with Russell if I didn't congratulate them. And so being a part of a club and being part of our community in that way is a place where the light gets to shine and where the salt gets salty. We need to be in communities. We need to be part of groups and part of our community, and I think it's a wonderful thing. And so, yeah. Let's bow and pray just for a moment. Lord Jesus, we have come to hear from your word this morning. We have come to hear it through the ears of your spirit. I don't trust that I have the ability to communicate it well enough. I don't trust that the people here have the ability to hear it without that help of the spirit. And so, Holy Spirit, we're trusting you to speak to us and into our lives today, and we ask that you would empower your word today by your spirit. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. So words are a big deal. Is it an overstatement to say that lives hang in the balance with words? How is influence peddled? How is information shaped to affect the decisions that individuals or families or organizations, even churches and governments, make? How much do teachers in our schools or preachers or bloggers or political platforms that are written down in words on pages impact all of us? How much do the words in this book impact you? How much are they in your heart? How about the words that you read on Google? How often did you access Google this week to learn something or how to do something? Words spoken in pivotal moments of life that direct us one way or another. Words that are heard, sometimes ignored, sometimes accepted. Words that are intended to be believed, and sometimes, sadly, words that are offered to be deceptive. How powerful are the words in your head or heart that rule you? Those tapes that you hear over and over again, Who spoke them over you? How long ago? How many of you have words that still ring in your mind and in your heart from when you were children? And you know they still impact you. Were they true? Are they still true? Words. James 3 talks about the tongue, talks about the words that we speak, that the tongue is a very small member of our body, but it boasts of incredible things, and it says that it can defile the entire body. In Proverbs 18:21, it says death and life are in the power of the tongue. Hebrews 4 says the word of God is living and active and powerful. I pray that it is for you this morning. And listen to this tremendous quote from Samuel, who we just referenced earlier. It says that the Lord was with him and let none of his words fail. Can you imagine if that was said about you, that God let none of the words that you spoke fail or fall to the ground in one translation? Words are powerful, and they move people to action, and they also reveal the heart. Listen to what Jesus said in Matthew 12. For the mouth speaks out of that which fills the heart. The good man brings out of his good treasure what is good, and the evil man brings out of his evil treasure, treasure being heart, what is evil. Now, this is the intimidating part. But I tell you that every careless word that people speak, they shall give an accounting for it in the day of judgment. For by your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned. Who finds that incredibly intimidating? That every word, and I'm going to say not just that you speak, but all those words that we write down, that we blog, that we social media, every one of them. Our text today is all about people speaking words, God's words, and Peter and the apostles, their words, and the Sanhedrin, what their words were, and then one man in particular, his name is Gamaliel. Let's just contextualize ourselves here to the text before we turn to Acts chapter 5. In the first months of the church, it had been very dramatic for sure. There were powerful forces at work. The Spirit of God was at work, but so were the spirit of Antichrist, and they were at loggerheads, and they were battling together. And so now the apostles have been arrested twice, and then the Holy Spirit sets them free and plunks them right back into the temple, and now the entire apostolic group is back in the Sanhedrin's jail. The message that the Lord Jesus, the Holy Spirit, and most recently the angel of the Lord had instructed them to teach, the words that they were to say, it says, speak to the people in the temple the whole message of this life. Speak to them all about the life and salvation that come in Jesus. And they were unapologetically loyal to the risen Lord Jesus, and they were faithfully preaching that word. Can we just take a moment of reflection here? Can I ask you, are you and I unapologetic when it comes to talking about Jesus? Are you unapologetic about the Lord that you serve, about who it is, and what you're all about? Well, this whole drama was being played out in a courtroom setting. I should have actually probably talked to a lawyer about the courtroom setting of Acts, because there's a lot of stuff going on in the courtroom. The Jewish high court was 71 men, including the high priest himself. The graphic that you can see, we'll be able to see here shortly. Is it coming, Lise? There we go. That tiny little red dot on the bottom is the little corner of the temple where this room was. But can you imagine being on trial and standing there? Look at the jury around you. I mean, talk about intimidating. And the high priest standing there. And these guys were very powerful. And that's where this courtroom was located. It was the chamber of hewn stone just inside of Herod's temple. And it was in this place that the words that were spoken and the decisions that were made definitely changed lives. The Jewish religious and political leadership, which were sitting around this outside of this building, they were numerically and politically dominated by the anti-supernatural Sadducees. They did not believe in resurrection or in angels or any of those sorts of things. And they had taken a strong dislike to the apostles and what they were preaching. And the stakes were escalating more and more, as the witness of the apostles and of what Jesus was doing in the temple was forcing their hand more and more. And when they finally corralled these guys and herd them back into this courtroom, Peter's words of defending Jesus have the Sanhedrin intent on killing them. That's how powerful his words were. And that's the impact that his words had on them. Ironically, when we consider what Jesus said in Matthew 12 about every word being weighed by the Lord, It's clear that the apostles weren't the only ones on trial here, but there was a higher court. Many of you know that when words are being spoken, it's not just what happens in a natural courtroom. It's not just what happens when you're challenged in your faith, but there is a higher judge who is listening to the words as well. And we're all accountable for the positions that we take and the words that we say. But I can, they all claimed truth, but can we lay stake? Could you say this about yourself? Paul would write in 2 Timothy, "For this reason I also suffer these things, but I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed, and I am convinced that he is able to guard what I have entrusted to him." Can you say that? Can you walk and live in this world with the assurance that you are not ashamed of the name of Jesus, and that you know who you believe, and that you're willing to take your stand and take your stand in his name? The apostles did. And this now is the third time, and so they've gone quietly with the temple guard, and why not? Last time the Lord sprung them. But, of course, the Sadducees don't believe. In fact, in Acts 23, we actually learn that the Sadducees say there is no resurrection, nor angels, nor a spirit, but the Pharisees acknowledge these things. So the Sanhedrin, this court, although it was dominated by the Sadducees, the Pharisees were not anti-supernatural. And so we're going to see that this little bit of a rift actually creates some space for God to use. What are the charges that are against them? First, you ignored our words. That's what the Sanhedrin said. We told you not to preach, and you did anyway. Peter and John had not obeyed the official orders to stop preaching in the name of Jesus. Second, they said, "We don't like your words. Not only did you stop, but we don't like what you say when you do speak." Their witness of the resurrection was directly refuting the Sadducees' doctrine, and they did not like it. And they said, "You filled Jerusalem with this doctrine." So Peter has outright assigned them blame for Jesus' death. And shockingly, what people do in the heat of the moment, they often deny afterwards. This same group, in their jealousy of Jesus, had cried at Jesus' trial, "What should we do with Jesus? Crucify him." And then they said, "Let his blood be on us and our children." And all Peter did was say, "Don't you remember when you said that? You are guilty. You did that." But now, in their jealousy, they are after these guys. But as blame's package has arrived at the door, blame that they welcomed, "Let his blood be on us and our children," now they claim they're not responsible for it. They don't want to sign for it. You ever order something from Amazon and then not want it? These guys placed the order, but when the repercussions came down, they did not want it. However, denial doesn't erase our history. And Peter wasn't letting them off the hook. They were convicted by their conscience, and they were convicted by their words. The third thing that they done, the real and understated reason, was that they were filled with envy at the great success and that these untrained and unauthorized men were having. They knew that their traditions had nowhere near the impact on the lives of people that they were watching unfold in the temple, and that made them furious. Even envy can be hidden under the disguise of defending the faith, and so under that disguise, they have arrested the disciples. They took the gospel's success as a personal attack on their role, on their theology, on their credibility, and on their popularity, and they were going to defend it at all costs. And they haven't learned a thing since the trial of Jesus. They're about to make the same mistake they made with Jesus all over again. In Ephesians 4, it says, "Be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and do not give the devil an opportunity." How many of you have learned that your anger and your temper can get you in a lot of trouble? Whose big mouth has gotten them in a lot of trouble? I remember playing a hockey game in Claremont. And there was a guy who was a very dirty hockey player on the other team. I was playing out there with Russell, and Russell told me to shut up, but I didn't. And so this guy was dirty, and I was beaking him from the bench. I was standing on the bench, and he came by the bench, and he says, "Well, are you going to say that again?" And I said, "Yeah, I'll say it again." And as I started talking, he just reached over the bench and punched me in the face. And Russell was laughing. And I kind of thought, well, you asked for that one, didn't you? Because he was a big guy. Has your anger ever gotten you punched in the face? Maybe not, but it's probably gotten you in trouble. And these guys, in their anger, were prepared to murder the apostles. And they were getting in trouble. They had given the enemy an opportunity to take over their hearts. And remember, the things that you say are a reflection of your heart. And so we could see what was in these guys' hearts. They are out of their minds angry to find that the gospel of Christ had so much to recommend it, that it was likely to keep gaining ground, and that they were absolutely powerless to offer anything to compete with what Jesus was doing for the people. And so when Peter preached the same message to the masses after Pentecost, it says that they responded with godly sorrow and thousands got saved. He preached almost the identical message to the Sanhedrin, and it says that these leaders were cut to the heart, but their reaction was to actually threaten to kill them all. How different is the response to the same message? Just a moment of reflection here. Is it worth asking whose fault it is when you go to church and get nothing out of the message? Just a thought. The same message produced repentance unto salvation and produced a murder plot. The same words. Enraged, the Sadducean contingent is calling for the death sentence, but the Pharisaic members of this court, although they're in the minority, have more credibility with the people. And you'll remember when the temple guards went to arrest them, they were actually afraid of the people. And so they couldn't do whatever they wanted to do without getting the Pharisees on their side. And there was one exceptional man who would now speak up into this trial. He's a unique figure, and we're introduced to Gamaliel in Acts 5, verse 34 to 40. Turn there in your Bibles if you haven't already. So we read, "But a Pharisee named Gamaliel, a teacher of the law, respected by all the people, stood up in the council and gave orders to put the defendants outside for a short time." So Gamaliel is a celebrated Jewish wise teacher. He is the son of Simeon, probably the same Simeon who, when Jesus was brought to the temple, recognized who Jesus was. This was his son. And he was the grandson of a great Bible teacher, a great Old Testament scholar called Hillel, who actually had a college. It was like a Bible school, and Gamaliel would eventually take over this school. He was a celebrated rabbi and a great teacher of the law, it says. He was also the teacher of Saul, who would become Paul, and later becomes the president of the Sanhedrin. He is the first one to be given the name, not just rabbi, but rabbon, which was an elevated title. It would be like I don't know what it would be like. But it wasn't just a teacher. He was like he was regarded as the highest authority on the scriptures of his day. And so he had tremendous credibility. And so Gamaliel is not a Sadducee, but he's so respected that they actually listen to him. He appears here as a loyal Pharisee, as a doctor of the law. And that phrase is used by Luke to also describe those who would come to Jesus with theological puzzles. Do you remember how they'd always try to catch Jesus? Okay, so if a man marries a woman and then he dies and then his brother marries him and then all seven brothers marry him and so on, whose wife will she be in the eternity? Like those kind of questions, like these kind of conundrums. And so they kept trying to trap Jesus, but that was actually the kind of doctor of the law that Gamaliel was. He was a theological student, and they knew the word really well. He was a man of judicial temper, according to history, and he wasn't prone to go off on the tangent like the Sadducees had gone. And so there's Gamaliel, why he defends the apostles in the text to come isn't actually very clear. Was it to make a point against the theology of the Sadducees? Could be. Was it to preserve the integrity of the law and of this court? Maybe. Was it to keep from repeating the fiasco that Jesus' trial and death had become? Because this had become a tremendous problem for them. We're not really sure. But we pick up his words, and it says, he said to them, "Men of Israel, take care what you propose to do with these men." His address to them, "men of Israel," he's basically saying, listen, good leaders are not emotional reactionaries. You need caution. And he feels compelled to call them to just stop and think about what they're doing before they make a huge mistake. And he's going to do that in private, not in front of the apostles. And so he says, men of Israel, get a hold of yourselves. Get a grip. Get a grip. You're not acting like the leaders of a nation. You're acting like a bunch of emotional, insane people. Your anger has driven you mad. And you are supposed to be the leading men of Israel, governed by reason, governed by revelation, not like heathens who pay no regard to what God has said and who don't know his word. And so he says, take heed to yourselves and to your anger, lest you do something you regret. So he's stopping them. I also think he maybe removed the apostles because the Sanhedrin needed a time out. Have you ever given a kid a time out because they just were out of control? These guys needed a time out. So we pick it up in his argument. He goes on to say, for some time ago, Theudas rose up, claiming to be somebody, and a group of about 400 men joined up with him, but he was killed, and all who followed him were dispersed, and it came to nothing. Verse 37, after this man, Judas of Galilee rose up in the days of the census and drew away some people after him, and he too perished, and all those who followed him were scattered. Who are these two figures in history? We don't really know who the first guy is, but Judas of Galilee might be the one who history does recount. Josephus gives a rather full account of it, and in the Gospel of Luke chapter 13, it says somebody came to tell Jesus about Pilate, who had mingled the Galilean sacrifices, the blood of the sacrifices, with their blood. This may be have been this uprising, Judas of Galilee. Now, the Galileans were kind of known to be troublemakers, and by the way, where was Jesus from? Yeah, and these guys were rebellious. There was constantly these rebellions, and they were putting these things down all the time. And so there was definitely some examples that they could look at to say, listen, these guys come and go, and Jesus will be one of those guys who come and go, but not if you turn this into a murderous fiasco. And so he's trying to make a case. So he says in verse 38, and so in the present case, I say to you, stay away from these men and let them alone. For this plan or action is of men, it will be overthrown. But if it's of God, you will not be able to overthrow them, or you may even be found fighting against God. Now, I've often read these words and thought Gamaliel was a real voice of reason. And I think God was able to use him to certainly spare the lives of the apostles in this case. And it all sounds reasonable, but I would suggest to you today that Gamaliel is hardly objective. And the title of my message this morning is Living Gray in a Black and White World. And this is what Gamaliel's about to try to do. He's going to try to live the gray space between two completely opposite sides. And I'm going to think we're going to find out, and there are some lessons to learn. So while he is moderate in his approach, this is a chance for the Sanhedrin to actually get to the bottom of this debate. This is a once-in-a-lifetime debate. They have a legitimate example and miraculous events happening around them. This could actually be the coming of the promised Messiah. Now, they weren't sure. We know by history that Jesus certainly was the real deal. But give them a little grace and say, in the moment, they didn't know. But here's Gamaliel and the Sanhedrin. They had a chance to do a full investigation to really figure out, who is this Jesus? What's really happening? Does this line up with Scripture? This was the moment to dig in and settle it. There was a chance to figure out what is black and what is white. But they blow it. They miss it. We can see his bias. If he was defending them, he shouldn't have allowed their brutal whipping. Because later on, they don't kill them, but they whip them with 39 lashes. Now, many people actually died from that whipping. This wasn't a spanking. This was a flogging. What he does right is that he remains civil in the face of tremendous heated situation. That's a good example. And when the Sanhedrin openly challenges the apostles' gospel, he speaks up on their defense for proper procedure. And so he remains civil and he speaks up. That's good. But he also makes some mistakes. I think we can say that he's probably not truly open-minded to consider the evidence before him. What does he presume? this Jesus is just like the other two guys, the other two examples, because he's using them as illustrations. It's probably like that. He's already prejudged the case. And so while he's being moderate, he's also being biased. And then he fails to apply his convictions to their logical conclusion. Because if what he says is true, that we could actually find ourselves fighting against God, so we should leave these guys alone, then he should have also defended them from a flogging. Because in the case that they are actually of God, we don't want to be flogging God's servants. So why did he let them get flogged? Because sometimes you and I, and sometimes even great leaders and teachers like Gamaliel, can get drawn into a gray world where we try to straddle both sides of the issue. Have you ever been guilty of compromise? Of saying something, but leaving a bit on the table too. Not maybe going all the way. Not wanting to confront, not wanting to hurt, not wanting to insult, not wanting to tell someone they're a sinner who needs to repent and needs Jesus. Have we ever pulled it? Pulled the punch a little bit? The biggest weakness of his advice was his motive. He encouraged neutrality to the council, but was facing a life and death issue that demanded a decision. Wait and see is actually not being neutral. Flogging them is not being neutral. Gamaliel was voting no, but he was preaching maybe, and it was confusing. Let's just stop and think about that for a moment. Do we ever take partial stands for the truth? I've debated theology with atheists, with agnostics, Mormons, Jehovah's Witnesses, and even occasionally with a Muslim. That one wasn't very deep, but we did chat for a bit. And I'll have to say that though we were all trying to convert each other, right? I mean, that's what's going on, right? We're arguing about what's true. We're all trying to convert each other. One thing that all of those conversations had in common was at least we all understood we're not all right. We can't all be right because we're saying different things. And you know, there's just an honesty about that. Even in debating theology and debating who Jesus is with people of other religions, at least we know that we're not all saying the same thing. I think this all paths lead to heaven is a Gamaliel approach to spiritual life. It's just not true. All these different paths cannot lead to the same place. These different versions of who Jesus is are not the same Jesus. And so it's okay to say that. It's okay to acknowledge that when we have a conversation with people. Because when you're saying different things, 1 + 1 cannot equal 2, 3, or 4. There is a right answer. And we're looking for it. And I think we can all trust God to lead people of good conscience who are seeking the truth to find it. And so spiritual compromise, especially in our culture, is expected and even applauded, but I'm sorry, it's just not a possibility for us as Christians. It's disingenuous to tell somebody, well, that's good. It's good that you believe in a God. That's not evangelism. I'm not sure what it is. I think it's living gray in a black and white world. I think we need to make sure that we declare all of the message of this life. That was what the angel told them to preach. And all that said, Gamaliel's words have an impact on the trial. Whatever he wanted to do, whatever he was trying to do, it does have an impact. God is able to use it. And they took his advice, it says in verse 40, and after calling the apostles in, they flogged them and ordered them not to speak in the name of Jesus and released them again. Well, I think a pattern is developing. If Gamaliel was really not wanting to fight against God, why didn't he honestly investigate it? This was the moment. Daniel Defoe, who was the author of Robinson Crusoe, claimed that nobody was born a coward. He said this, truth makes a man of courage, and guilt makes a man of courage into a coward. The apostles were true ambassadors of God. Gamaliel was being a religious politician. And that's not the same. Saul, who was his disciple, we know about him, and you're going to learn about him in the days to come through Pastor Steve's messages. Saul, we know, would go about terrorizing the church. He would become the attack dog of the Sanhedrin. But when he was confronted by Jesus on the Damascus road, Saul made a better decision that day than Gamaliel made. Saul made a decision to surrender to Christ. Gamaliel, while he may have defended the apostles and the correct legal proceedings of the moment, he did not manage to save his own soul. He did not make the decision concerning Jesus. In spite of the bloody beating, we read in verse 41 and 2, the apostles left the Sanhedrin. What? They were flogged within an inch of their life, and they're bleeding, and they drag their bloody carcasses out of this room, out of this place, and they do what? They're rejoicing. I just want to say right up front, I have not mastered that. I have not mastered rejoicing at persecution, rejoicing at being called names, rejoicing at being told I'm an idiot for believing in Jesus. I have a hard time not being angry. But there are lessons to be learned, and it says that the apostles were honored to be suffering disgrace for Jesus. In later years, Peter would have much to say about the role of suffering in his epistle, the meaning of suffering in the life of the believer, and it was here and now that he was learning those lessons that he would reflect on later and write in letters to the church. The opposition of men meant the approval of God. And it was actually a privilege to suffer for Jesus, who had suffered for them. Peter encourages Christians to rejoice when they participate in the things of God, including suffering for Jesus' name. Can we draw a couple lessons about what happens today? Number one, let's determine not to try live gray in the places where Jesus has told us, no, this world is black and white. How many of you are committed to that? That's surprisingly few people for a church service. If you put your hand up, God will watch. And he'll help you. Do you remember when God said, don't fear when you're called to give an account for the things you say, when you're brought before kings and authorities? I will tell you in that very moment exactly what you should say. Don't worry about being inadequate. Just share and witness what you know. But don't be afraid to be white in a black world. And don't compromise your way down to gray. Be willing to stand for Jesus. I think some other lessons too. I'd like to say that when you come into confrontation like the apostles did, like Gamaliel was in, the Sanhedrin were murderous. I mean, there was intensity here, right? I would say that when we're in conflict situations, it's easier to fight than it is to talk and listen. But one thing that Gamaliel did right was he calmed people down a bit, and there was able to be some talking. I don't know if there was listening, but at least there was talking. And I think sometimes when we get into disagreements on the basis of principle and truth, it often reverts to verbal and sometimes even physical violence, sometimes both. It's a huge challenge to listen to somebody of another opinion and remain humble, and most importantly, to stay Christ-like. Have you ever felt defensive over your faith? Have you ever felt attacked and wanted to lash out in anger at those who would attack you for your belief in Jesus? That's not what the disciples did. It's not what Jesus did. In fact, Jesus was quiet at his trial. He didn't even feel the need to defend himself. He didn't feel like he answered to them. He didn't answer to Pilate. He answered to God until eventually he did say something. We have a tragic history of branding all of our wars as holy wars and branding all of our fights with the name of Jesus, but If we're going to use Jesus' name and fight for his cause, we need to not only fight for what Jesus talks about, but fight like Jesus fights. We need to wage the battle in the way Jesus would wage it. And that means we have to maintain a Christ-like heart and a Christ-like attitude. You know, later on, Saul has now become Paul, and it says that the first thing Paul did every time he went to a new place to share the gospel, he would start in the synagogue with the people that he had once been a part of, and he would try to bring them to Christ. And the early church always tried to bring their brethren, to bring the other Jewish people into the kingdom of God. In spite of how they'd been treated, in spite of how they'd been persecuted and attacked, they still tried to bring them to Jesus. That is like Jesus. William Temple said that Christians are called to the hardest of all tasks, to fight without hatred, to resist without bitterness, and in the end, if God should grant it, to triumph without vindictiveness. When I look back at the last 2 years, I'm afraid that the North American church largely failed during COVID. Not failed to be black and white, but failed to be like Jesus. Failed to reflect him. Our heart, we're exposed by our words, and not just by the content of them, but by the tone of them. And I can't help but think that I heard a lot of angry Christians over the last 2 years. How many of you heard it too? Angry, frustrated. I get it. Can I admit that I'm one of them? But you keep that inside, and when you're in the world, you are there as a representative and ambassador of Jesus. And I think what Peter and the apostles did in the face of now three trials and threats and now a scourging to maintain the Christ-likeness of their Lord was just an amazing example to us. Jesus said, and I would say this just looking back at Gamaliel's situation, he said, "He who is not with me is against me. He who does not gather with me scatters." The gray world is not on Jesus' side. Jesus said, "If you're ashamed of me before man, I'll be ashamed of you before my Father." I don't want the Lord to be ashamed of me. I don't want to live my life halfway in the kingdom and then come to the end and find out that it was all for naught because I was afraid to be black and white. I'm not saying go looking for trouble. I'm just saying, be Christian. Speak the truth in the greatest of love, with the greatest of humility, and take Jesus' side. In the world that's coming, in the battles that are coming, it's going to be a challenging world, and there won't be room for gray. I want to encourage you to be courageous. In Romans 10, it says, "If we confess with our mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart a person believes, resulting in righteousness, and with our mouth we confess, resulting in salvation." Can you be a non-confessional Christian? Can you be a secret Christian without letting anybody know, without ever naming the name of Jesus? I wouldn't want to try. I wouldn't want to take the gamble. Don't be ashamed of your faith. Gamaliel is wise and he's prudent. He is a learned man of the law. But if there's one thing that his life was supposed to stand for, it was supposed to be the defense of truth and contending for the truth of God's word in a nation where he was a leader. And when it came to that, he may have preserved the disciples' life, but we don't know if he ever got to the place where he preserved his own by submitting to Jesus. And every day, in the temple and from house to house, they kept right on teaching and preaching Jesus. That's our task. Every day, in the temple, in our community, from house to house, let's take our stand for Jesus. Go and stand, the angel told them, and speak to the people in the temple this whole message of this life. You have the words in your heart that can change forever somebody's eternity. You have the words in your heart that change lives forever. Don't keep them to yourself. Let them be heard. Let's bow and pray. Heavenly Father, as we speak these words this morning, I want to thank you for the Word of God, which is uncompromising in its truth. And Lord, you teach us often to be gracious and kind and gentle and all those things, but you also teach us to speak the truth. And Father, I want to pray for each one who is here this morning that we would be a reflection and that we would be vocal. That's unfortunate timing, eh? That we would take our stand for the truth. Lord, we're not distracted by a phone. We understand what we're talking about here this morning. If you want to be that kind of believer that doesn't walk the gray world, but knows black and white, but you're not sure you're qualified, you're not sure you'll have the words, but you want the Holy Spirit to help you just be that black and white, honest, straightforward person, would you just raise your hand this morning? Lord, you can see that we're not sure what's coming at us in these days, but one thing we do know, that you promised to be with us and you promised us the Holy Spirit who would help us and give us words. And so, Lord, for each one this morning who's willing to be salt and light in this world, I want to pray for a fresh anointing, a fresh touch of the Spirit, and a fresh confidence that you will be with us, a fresh confidence that you will give us the words to speak in the right way that will touch people's hearts and lives. Holy Spirit, would you please give us opportunity to name your name and to share with people the life-changing message of the gospel? We ask for this, Lord, humbly, not to be troublemakers, not to be combative, but to be conduits for others to the knowledge of Jesus. Lord, we thank you for the example of the Scripture, and I pray, Lord, you'll help us to live the example you're giving us today from your word. And is there anyone here this morning who's never made a commitment to Jesus Christ? Did you know you have to repent of your sin? Maybe nobody's told you. Well, the Word of God is telling us. But if you believe Jesus has raised from the dead and you believe that he died for your sin and you're willing to give your life to him and invite him in, he will cleanse you, he will make you a new creation, and your life will be changed. And if you're here this morning and you've never made that decision but you'd like to, I'd like you just to raise your hand. All of our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed, but if you've never made that choice, I want to give you the chance. I'm looking up in the balcony. God bless you. Is there anyone else? We're going to pray because somebody's raised their hand this morning. So can we all pray out loud together? And if you didn't raise your hand, but you pray this prayer with sincerity, I believe God's going to listen to you this morning and you're going to receive a gift of life. Pray, Lord Jesus, thank you for loving me. Thank you for dying on the cross to save us from our sin. We acknowledge that we have needed a Savior. I confess my sin to you, Lord. I've run my life my own way without regard for you. But today, Lord, I want to live for you. And so I invite you, be my Lord and my Savior. Forgive me of my sin. Cleanse me and make me new. I thank you that you're going to help me walk this new world, this new life, by the power of your Spirit. I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, if you've prayed that prayer, that's the confession part. With our mouths, we confess. You've made a confession. But the Bible says that salvation that saves starts with the belief in the heart. And the belief of the heart produces righteousness. It produces follow through. So I want to encourage you now that you've made this profession, I want to encourage you to follow through. Tell those who you know who are Christians that you've made this commitment. Begin to expect God to change your appetites, your affections, your language, some of the life decisions you've been making in the past, that new things will come and some old things will pass away. This is the true evidence that you've entered the kingdom of God. And we want to help you. Let us know. We want to walk with you and encourage you as you go. Let's all stand together. Let's go eat. Amen. Let's eat. Father, thank you that we get spiritual food first, and then we get great food prepared by people. Lord, as we go to our time of fellowship, I pray your blessing on it. I pray that you would allow us to bond and knit our hearts together over these wonderful refreshments. Thank you for those who prepared them and brought them. And Lord, we look forward to this, and we pray a special blessing on our baptismal candidates for this afternoon. In Jesus' name, all God's people said, amen. Bon appetit. If you would like prayer this morning, come and find us up here at the altar or pray with someone beside you. We'd be happy to join you and meet you. God bless you.